5 Lesson 3, where we'll be testing claims about means when sigma's known. You'll notice for this lesson that the steps to do these problems look very familiar, as these are all the same steps that we outlined in the previous lesson. In the previous lesson, we looked at an overview of all types of hypothesis tests. In this lesson, we're going to focus on one specific situation, the mean when sigma's known. There's actually a different process for when the sigma's unknown, and we'll learn that in lesson 4. Just a reminder, the sigma represents the population standard deviation. So we'll be dealing with problems in this lesson where the population standard deviation is known. So what we're going to do for the first problem is we're going to see the problem, and then we're going to go through each one of these individual steps and see how we do them. Then we'll put it all together at the end with one big problem. So let's take a look at the problem. People have died in boat accidents because of an obsolete estimate of the mean weight of men. We want to investigate what the real average weight of a man is. So we collect some data. And out of the 40 people that we sample, so N is 40, we get a sample average of 172.55 pounds. Remember, X bar is the sample mean. We have some research that suggests that sigma equals 26 pounds. This means that we know sigma, which is actually really important. As we mentioned, it's a different type of problem if you don't know sigma. So we're going to use these results to test the claim that men have a mean weight greater than 166.3. It's always important to make sure you know what your claim is, as that's going to be used to set up our hypotheses. And we're going to test this at the 0.05 significance level. So as you can tell, this is a meaty problem. There's a lot of information up front. That can be overwhelming for people. But remember, we have a step-by-step process for how to do these problems. So just focus on one step at a time and keep referring back to the main problem to decide what information you need to use. So step one is to determine the null and alternative hypotheses. I'm going to start by writing these out. So each one of the hypotheses is going to have three parts. The middle of the null hypothesis is always equal to. The left part of each hypothesis is going to depend on what parameter we're talking about. Well, our claim talks about the mean, so that means this problem's talking about mu. So that'll be the left part of both hypotheses. The right part of the hypotheses will always be the same, and that's always going to have to do with what number is being suggested. Well, we see a lot of numbers here, but the suggestion in the claim is 166.3 pounds. So that's going to be the number part of each of these hypotheses. Now at this point, we've written out our null hypothesis. Remember, the null hypothesis is saying what's the status quo, and that means that we're assuming that the average weight of a man is 166.3. Remember they talked about an obsolete estimate of the mean weight of men? I'm guessing that's where they got this 166.3 number. That must be what people assumed the average weight of a man was. But we're trying to show whether or not it's greater than 166.3. And that's going to tell us what symbol to use here. Because it's being suggested that it's greater than, we're going to put a greater than symbol. And now we have our hypotheses. The null is that the average weight of a man is equal to 166.3. And the alternative is that the average weight of a man is greater than 166.3. Step two is to select our significance level, or our alpha. Well, that's easy for this problem because they told us it's 0.05. So now we have that, and we're ready to move on to step three, which is to calculate the appropriate test statistic. This test statistic right here is for when we're testing the mean with the sigma known. The test statistic will change based on what kind of problem you're doing. Now we need to start filling this out. So we need to figure out what each part of this formula is. The first is X bar, which is our sample mean. Going back to the original problem, the sample mean was 172.55. Next, we need the mu, which we can find from our hypotheses. It's 166.3. So now I have the first two parts of this formula, and since we know sigma, we can enter that next. We were told at the beginning of this problem that our sigma is 26. So 26 goes here, and then we need to divide by the square root of our n, which was also in that original information, that our n is 40. So I put 40 here, and now the formula is ready to calculate. I'm going to type this into Desmos, and I get 1.52, and that's my test statistic. Next, we want to determine the p-value. We start by drawing a picture. Remember, this picture is going to have z as its axis, and the middle is always 0, and we're going to put our test statistic, 1.52, on the axis. Now, which way we shade depends on the alternative hypothesis. This is a greater than, so we shade to the right. So I'm going to shade to the right of 1.52, and we're going to go back to Desmos. I'm going to go to distributions, normal dist, and I'm going to go cumulative from 1.52 to infinity, which gives me a p-value of 0.06, and we're ready to move on to the next step. The next step is the conclusion. I'm going to put my p-value, which we just calculated as 0.06, and set it less than or equal to My alpha, which remember was 0.05. And we're going to ask ourselves, is that true? Well, no, it's not. 0.06 is greater than 0.05. And since it's not, we're going to fail to reject, which you can abbreviate FTR. We fail to reject the null hypothesis. That's our conclusion. And finally, we need to write this out in non-technical terms. Remember the script we learned in the last lesson. Since we failed to reject, we're going to do the bottom part. There's not enough evidence at the, and our significance level is 0.05, we can abbreviate significance level SL, to suggest that, and now we just need to figure out what our alternative hypothesis in words would be. The alternative hypothesis was that the average weight of a man is greater than 166.3, and that's what we're going to say. So based on the script, this problem's done, and here's our answer. There's not enough evidence at the 0.05 significance level to suggest that the average weight of a man is greater than 166.3. However, let's take a step back and think about this problem critically. Our p-value is 0.06, which is very close to the significance level of 0.05. So while we weren't able to reject and show that the average weight of a man is greater than 166.3, we came pretty close. Remember that this p-value shows that there'd only be a 6% chance that we would be wrong if we concluded that the average weight is greater than 166.3. And that's where this language of there's not enough evidence comes in. Because honestly, if we collected more data, we'd probably get a lower p-value and be able to prove this. All right, let's move on to one more problem where we do it all. A designer claims that women have wrist breadths with a mean of 5. We collect some data and we have 40 women, so n equals 40, and that sample has a mean of 5.07. That's a sample mean, so x bar equals 5.07. We're being told that the population standard deviation is 0.33, so sigma equals 0.33. And they tell us to use the 0.05 significance level to test the claim. Well, the claim was right here, that the mean equals 5 centimeters. So let's start setting up our hypotheses. Well, we're talking about mean, so both the hypotheses are going to start with mu. The null is always equal to, and we have 5 here. That number is going to be the same for the alternative. Now, the symbol for the alternative here is going to be a little tricky. The claim was equal to, and we've already covered equal to at the null. So if they don't suggest greater than or less than the alternative is always going to be not equal to. So be careful with that. That can be confusing. Remember, step 2 now is to find our significance level. Well, we were told that alpha equals 0.05. So there's our significance level. After finding the hypotheses and the significance level, it's time to find our z. So I'm going to write out my formula. My x bar is 5.07. My mu from my hypothesis is 5. My standard deviation is 0.33, and my n is 40. And now we're ready to put this in the calculator, and I get a z of 1.34. Now it's time to draw our picture for the p-value, and put that 1.34 on the axis. Now, because this is a not equal to problem, we're going to shade to the smaller direction, which would be the right, and multiply by 2. We do that for all not equal to problems. So we're going to figure out that area to the right, putting in 1.34 to infinity, we get 0.09, and then we're going to multiply it by 2 to give us a p-val of 0.18. And now we're ready to start doing our conclusion. We're going to see if the p-value is less than alpha. Well, our alpha was 0.05, and 0.18 is not less than 0.05. So once again, we're going to fail to reject our null hypothesis. I'm going to steal most of our script from that last problem because it's going to be the same script. We just need to reword that alternative hypothesis. Remember that the alternative hypothesis said that the average wrist breadth was not equal to 5. So I write exactly what the alternative is saying, and this problem's done. And this is what a hypothesis test problem should look like. You need to show all the steps of finding the hypotheses, setting the significance level, finding the test statistic, getting your p-value, comparing the p-value to alpha, and then writing out your written conclusion. And that's what one problem looks like in this lesson. To summarize this lesson, hypothesis tests all follow the same general steps. The word problems can be a little overwhelming, so focus on one step at a time to determine what information you need to take from the original problem. If you came away with anything else, write that down now. Otherwise, we'll see you in the next lesson.